United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, Mr. Brenner.
Honorable Mayor Ron Shaver.
Here.
Councilmember Dan Marler.
Here.
Christine Casto.
She called in and is under the weather tonight.
Okay. Joe Segura Jr.
Here.
Clint Anderson.
Here.
Lisa Northrup.
Here.
Kevin Lindell.
Here.
First item on the agenda is approval of the minutes for the March 15th council meeting. Has everybody read and reviewed? Have any corrections, comments? Seeing none, I would entertain action by resolution.
Your Honor, I would offer a resolution approving the minutes of the March 15th, 2016 council meeting.
Second.
Have a resolution by Lisa Northrup, a second by Dan Marler. Vote by roll call.
That resolution carries on a unanimous vote of 6-0 with Councilmember Casto absent.
Next is resignation.
You're
going to hang around for a bit, Dave. Recognition of David Arndt as a 2015 Employee of the Year.
Did somebody tell me something I didn't know?
Mayor and Council, I'd like to present to you and the public and everyone else, David Arndt, who is our Employee of the Year 2015. We were going to do this a few weeks ago, but he was off getting more training. He's now our newest certified meter technician in the light power department. Just another example of things that David does to help our community. As you've seen, as we go through the various departments, and we'll be going to the electric department so he can show off a little bit more about what he does individually. I think you've noticed that the employees in each of the departments really have a passion for what they do, and they have a pride in their part in what makes our community great. And David has definitely shown that in how he did his job last year, how he stepped up and helped out in his department. I believe there were several people that actually nominated him for this award and had many great things to say about him. One of the things I really appreciate about it's David's on the official thing, is that he's always got a smile and he's always willing to step in and help out with whatever he's asked to do, and that's something I really appreciate about him, and I think it's reflective in his department. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to present him with a gift certificate and probably a less valuable certificate monetarily wise, but definitely recognition for his recognition as Employee of the Year. And I'm going to turn the time over to a supervisor to say a few things about him and what he really likes about him.
I don't really know what to say. Jeff kind of said it all. David did step up this year with our succession plan. We put in place. I asked David to step up and do some metering. So not only did he do two certifications, he did the merchant program for the metering, and you know how grueling that is. Mm-hmm. And then he just took the certification for the Rocky Mountain Meter School. So he's got two certifications. So I am very pleased that he stepped up and will be able to do the job. And like Jeff says, he comes to work with a smile on his face. Pretty easy employee to manage. Does whatever we ask him to do. So I appreciate that.
Well, you're not going to get away. You can come and say something. But one other thing that's great about Davey, you'll see from time to time, not only is he engaged and very effective at work, but I also see him regularly helping his wife with his four little boys, which I know that's a handful for anybody that has a lot of kids, but especially boys. So I know that not only is he effective at work, but he's effective at home. So if there's anything you want to add, it's all yours.
I just appreciate being recognized. I don't know if I fully deserve this or not, but I just come to work and love my job and love what I'm doing. That's how I look at it.
You deserve it.
You do deserve it.
So, Davey, be sure to thank your wife for all the support she gives you to be the Employee of the Year.
Next item on the agenda is a proclamation declaring April to be Child Abuse Prevention Month. With that, I'll read a proclamation from the city. Whereas children are key to the status, future, success, prosperity, and quality of life, and while children are our most precious resource, they are also the most vulnerable. And whereas children have the right to thrive, learn, and grow to their full potential, and whereas the prevention of child abuse and neglect strengthens Colorado's families and communities and ensures the opportunity for children to develop in healthy, trusting families, schools, and neighborhoods, which consequently builds the foundation of society. And whereas the state of Colorado is currently implementing initiatives for improving the self and well-being of children and families across Colorado, and whereas we must come together as partners to keep children safe, ensure that voices of our children are heard by all, and extend a helping hand to the children. And whereas each of us plays a role in the prevention of child abuse and neglect, and we encourage anyone concerned about the safety and the well-being of the children to report 1-844-CO4KIDS. And whereas call upon all Fort Morgan community members to provide safe, stable, and nurturing relationships and environments for our children, free of violence, abuse, and neglect, so we can ensure that Colorado's children will grow to their full potential as well as next generation of leaders, helping to ensure the future, to secure the future of this community, state, and nation. Therefore, I, Ronald Shaver, Mayor of Fort Morgan, Colorado, do hereby proclaim April 2016 to be Child Abuse Prevention Month in the city of Fort Morgan, and I urge all citizens to recognize this month by dedicating ourselves to the task of improving the quality of life for all of our children and families.
Thank you, Mayor. My name is Suzanne Brown. I am the manager for the Intake Unit for Child Protective Services, and I appreciate you partnering with the department to keep our kids safe.
Thank you. I really appreciate all that you do, and I will give you this proclamation. Thank you.
We do have a little token for you folks. It's a pin and a magnet that has the 877 number CO4KIDS to report child abuse and neglect. Thank you again. You.
Next, we have a reading of a proclamation declaring April to be Sexual Assault Awareness Month.
Ms. Bray.
And I will read this proclamation as well. Whereas Sexual Assault Awareness Month is intended to draw attention to the fact that sexual violence is widespread and has public health implications for every community member of the city of Fort Morgan, and whereas sexual assault and sexual harassment impact our community as seen by statistics indicating that 1 in 5 women and 1 in 7 men will have experienced sexual assault by the time they have completed college. And whereas we must work together to educate our community about what can be done to prevent sexual assault and how to support survivors. And whereas staff and volunteers of anti-violence programs in Fort Morgan encourage every person to speak out when witnessing acts of violence, however small. And whereas, with leadership, dedication, and encouragement, there is compelling evidence that we can be successful in reducing sexual violence in the city of Fort Morgan through prevention, education, increasing awareness, and holding perpetrators who commit acts of violence responsible for their actions. And whereas the city of Fort Morgan strongly supports the efforts of national, state, and local partners and of every citizen to actively engage in public and private efforts, including conversations about what sexual violence is, how to prevent it, how to help survivors connect with services, and how every segment of our society can work together to better address sexual violence. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the city of Fort Morgan joins SARA Incorporated, anti-sexual violence advocates, and support service programs in the belief that all community members be part of the solution to end sexual violence. Along with the United States government and the state of Colorado, I, Ronald Shaver, mayor of city of Fort Morgan, do by here proclaim April as Sexual Assault Awareness Month.
Thank you very much for your support. I've always been able to come to the city and ask for support in a lot of different ways, and I really do appreciate it. It's too bad we have to have this type of awareness, but it is an epidemic in our society, in our community, and it takes all of us to ensure safety within our community. I just wanted to mention three little things here that this month, we have Take Back the Night on April the 22nd. On April 13th, we're doing a presentation at MCC, and the presentation will be done by the therapists at my office, and they'll talk about how secondary victims and family members and friends can support the primary victims and their families. And on the 30th of April, we're going to celebrate our 10th anniversary. And for us, that is really big. It was hard for me to even imagine that we would maybe get through our first year, let alone 10 years. They went by quickly, and it's because of our community support that we were able to be as successful as we are. And so thank you very much, and I hope that some of you will join us that night. Thank you.
Here's a proclamation, Paula.
Next, we have the second reading of our public hearing and possible final approval of Ordinance 1180, renewing our cable franchise and authorizing to publish by title only. We now have a public hearing on the Ordinance number 1180, granting a non-exclusive franchise to Bresnan Communication LLC and its lawful successors, transferees and assigns for the rights to make reasonable and lawful use of the rights of way within the city to construct, operate, maintain, construct, repair, and upgrade the cable system for the purpose of providing cable services to citizens within the city of Fort Morgan and declaring an effective date. This is a public hearing. Please keep public comment to the issues before the city council. Each speaker will be asked to limit their comments to 3 minutes, unless the speaker represents a group of citizens in which event additional time will be allocated. Please respect these limitations. And I reserve the right to limit public comment that is inappropriate under these guidelines and otherwise improper. I also reserve the right to limit testimony or questioning that is repetitive, cumulative, argumentative, and not pertinent to the issues, and to set limits on the duration of the testimony if I deem it to be necessary in light of the number of persons who have signed up to testify. First is the issue of the legal notice. Mr. Brennan, has the hearing been properly noticed?
Yes, Your Honor. A legal notice of this public hearing and the full text of the ordinance being considered appeared in the Fort Morgan Times on March 18th.
Next is a presentation of the ordinance. Mr. Wells.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Nothing in the ordinance has changed substantially from the last time we presented it to City Council on first reading. I want to thank legal counsel for working hard on putting this together, not only Jason, but Mr. Feldman. It's been a long time to finally get everything negotiated in that final agreement. And I think we're ready to go forward. And I don't know if there are any modifications, Jason, that you've seen since the first reading that might be necessary.
It hasn't been a modification that's been made, but it has been brought to my attention that one of the whereas's in the ordinance itself specifies a term of 10 years. The franchise agreement that was agreed to and has been partially executed, waiting on the city's signatures, states that the term is for 15 years, so that would be an amendment that would need to be made. Also, the Emergency Operations Center located at 116 Main Street is what's in the ordinance. The Emergency Operations Center is actually at 901 East Beaver, which doesn't have cable service at this point. So those would be two modifications by resolution that would need to be done so we can have the ordinance published correctly to be in harmony with what the agreement itself states.
Jason, could you repeat what is the correct address?
The police department's 901 East Beaver. The address here is the fire department.
And as whereas where it says 10 years should be 15 years?
Yes. Correct.
Next, we will hear public comments if there's anybody who wishes to speak on this issue. If anyone else in the public wishes to speak, I'm seeing none. I will ask the city clerk if any oral or written comments have been submitted to the clerk's office prior to this hearing.
Actually, Your Honor, there have been. I received a phone call today from Jerry Wathen, who said he would be unable to attend this meeting tonight, and just wanted to let the council know that he has a little problem with charter. Everything goes off and on, off and on. He related that on January 1st, he wanted to see what the city council was doing on its agenda, so he turned on channel 191 and it was black, and it stayed that way until January 13th. He knows that the charter franchise is up for renewal tonight and asks that the council do one of two things, either don't renew it or don't renew it until all the problems customers are having with charter are solved.
Is that the only one? Is that it? Is that the only one?
That's the only one, yeah.
Okay. Are there any questions from council or discussion from council?
Your Honor, we discussed in the last council meeting when we had charter here about the fact that they were going to be reaching out to the residents in the complex where Mr. Wathen lives. Do we know a status update, or we have somebody here from charter that can speak to that?
I don't. Yes, she is.
Is it okay for her to come speak?
You came back for more?
I did. Good evening, thank you for the opportunity. Wendy Moser from Charter Communications. And following up on the council report last time, we checked into our list of locations, Hillcrest, Gateway, Pioneer, and Fremont. And we had a test, if you will, of the decibel levels from our end of the cable system into the building. They all tested within acceptable ranges. Management at Hillcrest and Fremont has replaced the cable at all of their following locations on their side of the building, including all outlets. And those two are also the two that tested better, even though all four were within acceptable ranges. We also had listed a Piedmont complex, and we need an address for that because that was not within our listings of available complexes that we found. But we did test the four that we were aware of. and they were all tested immediately after the meeting on the last meeting. I also would want the council to know that I have been in contact with the City of Rush, the Fort Morgan Community College, and the Morgan County School District, and thank you, Councilor Anderson. It's true they do broadcast on Monday nights. It's every other Monday, so they do not conflict with the broadcasts from Rush. It's first and third Mondays and second and fourth Mondays. We also talked about if anyone had, you know, contacted us, we would respond to them. We didn't receive any calls or contacts after the meeting from last week, but I will take Mr. Wappen's name and phone number and we'll reach out to him and follow up specifically with what his service issues are. With that, I'm available to answer any questions or address them.
Anybody have any questions? I think you got quite a few last time.
I did. That's okay.
I did speak with Jonathan Rogers at the college. He mentioned that there were some ghosting issues with the educational channel. He did mention that he had been working with you. That was a couple weeks ago. Has that been resolved?
It is not resolved in terms of how or when he would like to upgrade his equipment. I did speak with Monty Torres, the city manager for Brush, and verified their existing equipment, what feeds into City Hall and Brush, how they broadcast and what their expectations are. I also talked to Brian Amick, and I apologize if I mispronounce his name. He's with the Fort Morgan School District, and his indication is that he was perfectly fine with their connection and their service and wasn't anticipating making any changes. That was consistent with Mr. Torres. I then followed up with Mr. Rogers, and we are still going to try and work with him to see if we can figure out a nice solution for all three of those channels so that if the college would like to upgrade, they're free to do that. And I know he's got the equipment in mind that he would like to purchase, so we just want to coordinate it so we don't impact the school board, the school district, nor the City of Rush as we go forward with Mr. Rogers. And I'm still in touch with him and are working with him on that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anything else?
Thank you,
Wendy. Appreciate it. If there's no further discussion by council, I'd entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
A motion by Lisa Northrup, a second by Dan Marler. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? That carries. Now we will act on for council action, accepting the resolution on second reading.
The possible actions, you can either accept, deny, you could set this over for another date if that's what council would prefer. The recommendation would be to make the amendments, should you choose to accept, to make the amendments to the resolution, or a resolution with the amendments to the ordinance that were discussed previously to make sure that the contract matches what the ordinance states.
Mr. Myers, do I need to read the entire ordinance, or can I just refer to it as the by number?
You can do the heading. Okay. Is that what your question was?
I mean, I can read the approval by resolution of amendment number 1180. I don't have to read an ordinance.
I think it's clear in the record which ordinance we're talking about.
Right.
It's just a lot.
And then also the request to published by title only.
That entertain action.
Your Honor, I would offer a resolution upon second reading of amendment number, or ordinance number 1180, renewing the cable franchise with amendments to the term of 15 years and the Fort Morgan Police Department address correction to be 901 East Beaver Avenue upon second reading and to publish by title only.
Second.
I have a resolution by Lisa Northrup, a second by Joe Segura. Vote by roll call.
That resolution carries unanimously.
Next, we have council acting as the Board of Adjustments. Next on the agenda is a public hearing on a request for a variance from the municipal code regarding parking regulations at 516 West Railroad Avenue. City Council will be acting in its capacity as a Board of Adjustments for this agenda item. This again is a public hearing. Please keep public comments to the issues before the council as the Board of acting Board of Adjustments. Each speaker is asked to limit their time to 3 minutes unless the speaker represents a group of citizens, in which event additional time will be allotted. Please respect these limitations and reserve the right to limit public comment that is inappropriate under these guidelines or otherwise improper. I also reserve the right to limit testimony or questioning that is repetitive, cumulative, argumentative, or not pertinent to the issues, and to set the limit on the duration of testimony if I determine it is necessary in light of the number of persons who have signed up to testify. First is the issue of the legal notice. Mr. Brennan, was it properly noticed?
Yes, Your Honor, a legal notice of this public hearing appeared in the Fort Morgan Times on March 16th.
Next is a presentation of the application. Mr. Curtis.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. This is a variance to Chapter 20, Article 6, as it relates to an exemption of off-street parking requirements for the use of the building. The location is a vacant property at 516 West Railroad Avenue. We received this application. The property's been vacant for quite some time. Previously, it was used as a antique and secondhand location. We've received several informal inquiries over the past year regarding potential redevelopment of the property and the land use requirements per our code. In general, parking and ADA accessibility tend to be the most significant issues that come up. As mentioned, this property's functioned for several different types of uses over its lifespan, and upon staff review and in review of permits, there doesn't appear to be any expansions that would have created this limited parking issue that exists. The property owner is requesting to allow on-street parking in the city's rights-of-way, in addition to maximizing some of the space that they do have adjacent to the property. As it relates to issues, there's really only a couple items in our code. One is generally related to the sidewalks. The area out front has a lot of concrete out there, and in the past some vehicles have felt that they can park within that area even though there's still a safe sidewalk. They have used it for parking. We would want to make sure that that doesn't continue. But again, with the limited spaces, folks have tended to want to find room where they can. The other one is specifically off-street parking spaces must be provided on the same lot as the use served, except otherwise provided, and maybe also have additional parking within 300 feet of the main entry. As mentioned, this property is limited land available, as provided in the report. There is some available for parallel parking adjacent to the alleyway. And also, some have utilized some of the residential areas on the other side. This is a B2 zoning, and pretty much any use that applies under B2 zoning would have parking issues related to the uses. Through our analysis, there is several criteria that are set forth in the land use code. We have copied that in part as it applies to section 20-3-150. There's several 7 review criteria for the Board of Adjustments to evaluate. We have provided the exhibit of the application from Ms. Ritter and authorized representative, Mr. Purvis, as well as affidavit of publication. We have also sent out postcards to those within 300 feet and also posted the property for the general public. At the time of this memo, we have not received any public comments. Additionally, there has not been any known concerns or violations from the property in the current parking situation when it was occupied. Staff, upon the review of this variance request, appears to not pose any significant harm to the adjacent properties or public rights away by utilizing on-street parking. We did look at angled parking, but generally this area of the city doesn't have angled parking as a norm, so we would still recommend parallel. Staff does recommend council approve this case with the following conditions: that the on-street parking shall remain parallel parking in the area, that a minimum of 3 off-street parking stalls are utilized. In the report, it shows they may be able to get up to 6, but it depends on what they may have to do for ADA. Also, the property owner would be solely responsible for all applicable construction costs, permits, striping, operations and maintenance of the on-street parking immediately adjacent to this property. Also, that the on-street parking shall be also available to the general public and not and non-exclusive to the property. Any on-street parking modifications need to follow the city standards, similar to our driveway standards, and constructed with 6-inch non-reinforced concrete. And any applicable on-street or off-street ADA stalls and accesses shall be incorporated into the use of the building. And this variance would only be valid so long as the current building exists, meaning if the uses change, whatever the uses are, as it's allowable under the B2 zoning, that this variance would go. So if there's a transfer in ownership or a use, this variance would stick with that property. In addition, unless otherwise stated by the board, all variances must be implemented within 6 months from such date of variance is granted. And the applicant and the owner's representative are both here. If you have any questions? Or any for me, for that matter.
Those are the recommendations or the exceptions that you have on there?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Street parking. Okay. Any other comments, questions? Okay. Thanks, Brad. Comments by the applicant. Would you mind signing in?
Absolutely. Used to addressing a different city council, so this is a little bit different. I'm Tyler Purvis. I'm representing Ms. Deb Reeder, the owner of the property at hand, and there's not a whole lot to say. Mr. Curtis addressed all the different issues very well. When the property went on the market about a year ago, they have had numerous inquiries about it, and they actually have had contracts on it 3 times, and 2 of those times falling through because of the parking restrictions. And as Mr. Curtis alluded to, the property is, I don't want to say useless, but almost useless as it currently sits as far as parking requirements go. And so the only way to get around that is basically to either approve a variance or to demolish the building and rebuild something smaller in its place, which is unlikely. So there's opportunity right now. There, someone has been in contact with Ms. Reeder, not myself, about purchasing the building, and that contingent upon the variance approval or not. So I'd be happy to address any questions that you have.
Questions for Mr. Purvis? Is this going to increase our parking or traffic along there substantially, or is that this will be just for this
purchase and use of the property. If it changes or sells again.
What staff is requesting, and there might be a small modification on your part, but under the B2 zoning, what we looked at is staff looked at all the possible uses that could go under the current B2 zoning. And pretty much any analysis, that parking requirement's gonna be anywhere between one space for every 200 square feet to one space for every 300 square feet. And so to limit it to the next ownership by itself, then if that sells and someone else comes in and makes it different, and staff's recommendation is, so long as it meets a conforming B2 use, to allow that variance to stay in place with the land and not with just the ownership. Because as was mentioned, there's really no other way to occupy that building unless it sits predominantly as a warehouse, which allows 1 to 1,000 square feet. And that's not a good use. Over the years and other operating businesses along that street, they're almost all non-conforming. Generally, those businesses along West Railroad, they utilize that public street for all their parking needs. So this would just kind of go back to how it was operating previously. You may have some fluctuations and some increases potentially on the weekends. A church is an allowable use in B2. So if someone was to utilize it for a church similar to churches in residential areas on a Sunday, there might be lots of parking in that area, but generally retail and those kind of things, it's kind of a hit and miss on business operations and parking.
Okay.
Any other questions of the applicant or Mr. Curtis?
Nope.
Seeing none. Are there any public comments? If no one else from the public wishes to speak on this issue, and seeing none, I will ask the city clerk if there's been any oral or written comments.
Not by my office, Your Honor.
Does council have any discussion regarding the variance? None? Seeing none. I would entertain motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second. I have a motion to close by Lisa Northrup and a second by Kevin Lindell. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Next we have council action. Mr. Myers.
Council has the option of approving, denying, or continuing the public hearing to a later date. When looking at whether to approve or deny, as was provided in the packet, is the excerpt from the code, which lists the 7 different criteria to evaluate whether or not this particular variance meets those criteria. City Council, in doing that, should make findings on the record as to those requirements, and then make a decision as to whether to approve, or deny, or continue. So for instance, discussing whether this exists in the same zone or not would be a finding that council could make. Whether this denial of the variance would cause undue hardship would be a finding that the council would make, and make those brief findings for the record, and then a motion to approve, deny, or continue.
With that, I would entertain action.
Your Honor, I would offer a resolution approving a parking variance for 516 West Railroad Avenue for case number 16-002VA West Railroad parking variance, with the conditions contained within said variance and per section 20-3-150A3, the variance must be implemented within 6 months.
You want to include Brad's?
You want to add the little minor that it as long as the uses are consistent with the B2 zoning.
And as long as the usage is consistent with B2 subdivision.
Second.
That was not in my notes.
I have a resolution by Lisa Northrup, a second by Dan Marler. Vote by roll call.
That resolution carries unanimously.
Thank you, Mr. Purvis.
Come back anytime.
Next on the agenda is an update on the comprehensive plan. Mr. Curtis, Ms. Gondek, and...
We have item number 9.
Okay, definitely.
Oh, yes, we have the Ave Road in the wrong place. Thank you. We have another public hearing. As the Board of Adjustments for a variance on the sign code for the placement of a large real estate sign at Riverview Commons. This is a public hearing. Please keep public comment to the issues before the council, acting as Board of Adjustments. Each speaker is asked to limit the time to 3 minutes unless the speaker represents a group of citizens, in which event additional time may be allotted. Please respect these limitations. I reserve the right to limit public comment that is inappropriate and under these guidelines or otherwise improper. I also reserve the right to limit testimony and questioning that is repetitive, cumulative, argumentative, and not pertinent to the issues, and to set a limit on the duration of the testimony if I determine it is necessary in light of the number of persons who have signed up to testify. First issue is legal notice. Mr. Brennan.
Your Honor, a legal notice of this public hearing also appeared in the Fort Morgan Times on March 16th.
Next is a presentation of the application. Mr. Curtis.
Thank you. This is a sign variance or appeal request related to the vacant residential lands that are for sale in the Riverview Commons area, immediately adjacent to Interstate 76. A year ago, there was a similar variance appeal for the business property or the commercial property. As it relates to the city's code, sections 20-9-10 and portions of that spell out how the sizes of temporary real estate signs should be located and the maximum square footage and sign area. The request is in excess of that. Again, through the analysis in the land use code, there are 7 criteria of which to evaluate. We have provided the exhibit of the area and documentation from the applicant, Pueblo Trust and Bank, as submitted by the authorized representative, Ricard Velli. We've also provided the affidavit of publication. The property has been posted as well as postcards sent within a 300-foot radius. At the time of this memo, there's not been any public comments received, and there are no known violations from the property. Staff recommends that council approve this case. It was a variance of Chapter 20, Article 9, to allow a real estate sign not to exceed 10 feet by 12 feet. And not higher than 16 feet in height, and at the proposed location until such time the property is sold, and to allow for the unique nature of this property adjacent to the high-speed travel along I-76. Once it's sold, we would follow back to the normal code, which the signage would need to be removed within 7 days upon closing or a lease transaction. And again, per section 20-350A3, that this would need to be implemented within 6 months of the time of this variance is granted. Be happy to answer any questions for you. And the authorized representative is here today, too, to answer any questions you may have.
This is similar to the one we did down for the commercial side.
Yes, sir. It's in the same location and actually on the same alignment on that far north alley is where they're proposing it, but closer to the residential properties instead, which would be further to the west of where the current one exists.
We're not looking for any variance from what's already in. I know that's bad use of variance. We're not looking for any additional amendments to the action, correct? It's just
As stated, yeah, maximum of 10 by 12 and 16 foot high. That's very similar to what we did on the commercial property. So.
Does the applicant have any comments or wish to address council?
I'd like to thank the council for giving us the opportunity to apply for a variance, and basically this is very simple and cut and dry, I think, Mr. Curtis.
Your Honor, could we ask the gentleman to sign in, please? Yeah.
Next, are there any public comments? Does anybody wish to speak on this issue? Seeing none, I would ask if the clerk had any oral or written comments that were submitted to his office prior to this hearing.
No, Your Honor.
We'll proceed to the council decision. Are there any questions by council or any discussion on the issue? Seeing none, I would entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion by Lisa Northrup, a second by Kevin Lundell. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Council action?
Same as previously, can allow the variance, deny the variance, or continue this to a later date. The criteria for the variance was provided in the application packet that Mr. Curtis put into the packet, so that's the criteria to consider while making the decision.
I would entertain action.
Your Honor, I would offer a resolution approving case number 16-003VA, Riverview Commons sign variance as stated, and per section 20-3-15A3, the variance must be implemented within 6 months.
Second.
I have a resolution by Lisa Northrup and a second by Clint Anderson. Vote by roll call.
That resolution carries unanimously.
Next, we have an update on the comprehensive plan. Mr. Curtis, Ms. Gondek, and
thank you, Mayor and Council. We're going to provide an update with the comprehensive plan. So Christine is here with Logan Simpson, and she'll give you a brief overview of where we're at to date.
Hello, thanks for having me. Do I need to sign in? No. Only if I'm saying it's not public hearing anymore. Yeah, my name is Christina Kacher. We're with Logan Simpson. This is, I think, the first time you guys have been here, right? So briefly, we're a firm out of Fort Collins that was selected to guide the public and through this process of updating the comprehensive plan. Kicked it off back in October now. Saw many of you at stakeholder interviews. We've had a little bit about the process, where we've been and where we're going. Like I said, we kicked off with stakeholder interviews and a community event, Christmas Capital of the Plains event. I had a lot of fun there. And we've had a public meeting in February and a couple online surveys so far. Today I was spending time at a variety of places doing focus groups, getting the public involved in this process. And we'll be planning our third community event upcoming shortly. So just a reminder where we've been and where we're going. I'll cover some next steps at the end, but the plan should be wrapped up by July. Over the past couple months, we've been working with our TAC, which is members of the all of the department heads, as well as some members of the community and a student member as well, on developing different themes. We've come up with vision statements for each of these plan themes, and this is how the plan will be organized over all these seven themes that came from a little bit from the old plan and some new ideas we want to address in this upcoming future land use plan. And we've come up with vision statements for all of these. I think those were shared with you, but if not, I can get those to you. So the past couple months in February, we went to the public and asked for opportunity areas. How do we see this vision being fulfilled? So briefly, I'll just go over a few of some of the main highlights that the opportunities that we've heard from the public and from the stakeholders that we've met with and from the online surveys. Overall, housing, looking at mixing of housing types, more senior housing, affordability, not just low income, but sort of workforce housing, for our young professionals, and then enhancing, maybe aesthetics for existing neighborhoods. As far as land use and growth management, we've been talking about development within the existing boundaries. How can we infill and develop a little bit of where those areas, a few areas that can be infilled. How we can extend those boundaries, talking about contiguous development, next to the city boundaries. And I'll talk more about later county coordination on development standards and growth for the future. As far as economic development, we've heard a lot of people want to see downtown improvements. Of course, call out certain restaurants and shops that everybody wants to see. So the plan will focus on how to attract some of those development with an emphasis on what the city can do to attract that type of development. We've heard a lot of focus on tourism, of course, working with the county and the tourism groups, and also collaboration with the business communities and some working with the different downtown businesses as well as the industrial businesses in town. As far as community services and facilities, obviously coordination with the school district has come up a lot, providing educational opportunities both for high schoolers, adult education as well, working with the college. Recreation options, we keep hearing the recreation community center coming up. How do we implement that, or what are opportunities for that? emphasis on the South Platte River. We saw this in the previous comprehensive plan, as well as people wanting to see more trails, building off what's already been developed there, the disc golf, the great disc golf course that is now there. And then also communication between how do we get out information on what the city provides, but also with two residents, as well as across, sort of that economic development. How do you get visitors, information on what's going on in town? Transportation, you talked a little bit about, the grid system and keeping right-of-ways intact, especially for those major streets. Pedestrian and bike connectivity, we've heard a lot that there is a lot of walkable areas and we have wide streets that people can just bike down. But how to maybe identify those safer routes and maybe just getting out a map of, how to get around town better. Of course, more coordination with the school districts, on safety around the schools, and how can we partner with the schools and public transportation providers, because that's not something the city provides. And then other things such as truck routes and snow removal routes and partnering with the railroads on like quiet zones. We've heard a lot about that. Finally, the utilities, environmental quality hazards. Everybody, of course, wants to see upgraded fiber optic and expansion of that. Everyone praises the city for the services and utilities that are provided, but how can we continue that with more sustainable practices and also, you know, water, stormwater management, and then looking at some industrial impacts and how can we work with, you know, noise and odor and those types of things moving forward, and maybe how that plan, how the future land use plan could mitigate some of those impacts. Like I said, public involvement is really important to this process, so we've been getting out to the public multiple times. I will say that participation rates may be lower than expected, but another reason we've decided to do these focus groups today, we hung out with, I don't know, maybe 15 or 20 or so people at the senior center, the whole Rotary group, and then about another 30 people in Mr. Edson's class at the high school. So they were really engaged. It was fun to see them. Of course, they all want to see, you know, someplace to shop that's better, but cool thing, hip things to do. And I guess I'm not even that hip anymore. Also part of this process, moving forward as we look at the future growth boundary, the 2010 identified this boundary, but it didn't really have any teeth to it. So we're looking at a possible agreement with the county on how to cooperate on future growth. So yesterday we met with all three county commissioners and county staff on possible agreement for the future, and that would identify some boundaries. We talked about a tiered system that maybe there's certain coordination closer to the city, and then as we go out, maybe it's just sort of like a referral process, and you just, yeah, we're doing this, we're doing that, but there's no agreed upon agreements. And so some things we talked about were water. The county is interested in protecting those farm to market routes. Of course, traffic and access and rural versus, you know, urban traffic. One thing I forgot to put on here was sort of that density. Do we want to look at having more density within the city, and how can this agreement maybe control that, and having the rural landscape outside in the county areas? Of course, annexation and maybe possible ways we're going to do that. Is that question?
No, just
in it. So future next steps on county coordination will be drafting up some language, some things that we all agree upon, and that will also be coming to, if decides to happen, coming to you guys for approval. Next steps, we're going to continue working on the plan, and we'll be having a presence at the International Dance Festival and scheduling a public meeting shortly. We'll be meeting again with the TAC, so that will involve, you know, revisions of the goals and policy. Again, this future land use plan is broad brush visionary, but we do want to get down into some strategies eventually, and there'll be like an implementation piece at the end, so that will be coming up as well. And looking for a developed draft plan by the end of May, and that will also be coming to you guys for a review about that time. So that's probably this. Any questions? Anything else?
Yes, Jeff? No, I'd only make the comment as we go through this process that we're really trying to engage everybody and as many people as possible. What I really like about the process thus far is that a lot of time was taken to determine where we're at now and then get the vision of the community of where they want to go. And I think as we put those two pieces together, we're going to see what hurdles we need to get over. It's easy to go out and ask the community what they want, to ask staff what they want, to ask council members, what do you want to see, what do you expect from the expect Fort Morgan to be in 5 to 10 years. It's a lot harder to it's easy to put that down on paper. It's hard to achieve those things if you don't know where you're at now. And I think that's one of the really good aspects of this plan so far, is that we took a lot of time, and Logan Simpson took a lot of time to say, okay, where are we at now? And then we can put in, where do we want to be as a community? And when you match those two things up, we're going to see as staff and as council and as the community what we have to do to get there. And so I think that the process so far has been pretty good in outlining those two things of where, well, we're still working on where we want to be, but I think looking at where we're at is a really good framework, and hopefully the outcome of this is that we can identify those strategies that will get us to that where we want to be piece from where we're at right now.
Do you have any suggestions on how to improve the participation rates that we might not already be implementing?
Sure. It's definitely getting out and being a face-to-face, I think, with this community is really important to them, to you guys. And so coming to more events and being in the community more is that we're going to try to do that some more. And we've talked about posting more flyers, doing utility bill notifications, just more ways instead of just, we do have an email list. I hope you guys are all on it. I think you should be. But I don't think that's the only way we're going to be able to reach people.
So. More community barbecues.
More community free stuff.
That seems to bring them out.
Yeah. And I would sort of add to what Jeff was saying, this next round of public engagement will be sort of asking those big questions, big ideas, you know, where should this be if we're going to do it, or some bigger ideas that we're going to talk about.
Anybody else have any questions? And you're looking for this to be submitted to council around June or July, you say?
I believe the end of May, maybe early June, a draft will.
Well, we appreciate the work you're doing on it, and so hopefully it'll be a document well used by staff.
I hope so. Yeah.
So, what's the most interesting thing that you've learned in the process of engaging the community about Fort Morgan, and what's the most interesting thing that you've heard of where people want to be or want us to do?
What is most interesting? Probably the most interesting thing is people do have a lot of pride in this community and are involved in a lot of different aspects of the community. I feel like every person I meet is involved in more than one board, or they know other people, or they are, you know, connected to something else. And I think people are very involved in this community, but that hasn't been translating into coming out to public meetings. What is the second part? Very interesting thing, that where people want to go. There's sort of this conundrum between we love the small town feel. We moved out here because it's more rural than Denver. Heard that a lot. You know, we like being, you know, in this small town, but then also, you know, I mean, how do we balance that with all of the services and amenities that people want to see?
I'm sorry, Your Honor. I know you just asked the question a little bit ago, but I just sitting there and I sort of zoned out.
Sure.
But how about if we, I know we had, when the pot ordinance came out, we had like meetings at the different schools, and we did have somewhat of a turnout. Maybe if we do something like that with this, maybe we have some people maybe come to the little smaller meetings at the schools to talk about what they want to see come out. I mean, the park thing is a great idea, and I enjoy doing it, but people are there to enjoy the music and eat. But maybe we should think about doing that at the schools again, you know. Maybe people turn out on something like that. I didn't mean to zone out, but so on some new medications I'm trying to get used to, and sometimes that's what happens, but maybe that's something we can do, or churches or something that people may attend in smaller or in their local area. That's a thought. Because I know when we done the pot thing, we had quite a bit of people who did come out that, of course, that was an important issue, but growth of our community is an important issue as well.
Get that correct, Jenny. We're not doing a pot thing. We're
right, but.
Yes.
Yes, we have to do all
flowers.
Everything you want to add, Ms. Condect?
going to agree with her and say that I think the most exciting focus group today was the high school students. And I know that that was one of the components that council had requested, that you really bring in the youth. And in all honesty, I think they gave the most feedback I've ever witnessed in a public, you know, setting, and especially with the focus group. So that was really exciting. And I hope that we get to integrate a lot of their feedback and continue to get it. And we're really lucky that Aubrey decided to step forward and want to be a part of this, and ended up being on our TAC committee. And then she allowed us to come into her classroom today and talk about it. So I think that was a really great component.
I just thought of one other thing. What about putting an insert into like the utility billing, informing people about the site for the online surveys? I don't know if we do anything like that.
We've done that once. I think some of the things that we had noticed, we heard from the senior center that we did have quite a few that were there once they got engaged, but they had mentioned some people just walk in, look at the bulletin board, and leave. So that's one of the aspects that we've missed. We've got so many public facilities to make sure that that's out there. But again, it's, you know, we're trying to get names and numbers and get surveys. We know we can't get people out every evening and those kind of things. So we'll add another insert when we can find a month in there to update everybody. So we'll definitely incorporate that.
Good.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next, we have a presentation of possible action on the proposal for the sale of real property owned by the City of Fort Morgan and approval of a resolution authorizing the mayor to execute documents related to this sale.
You're next. Boy, you're next.
Granted, he has a gun.
I'm not the only one.
Next, I'll let him go next.
It's just because he has a gun.
I'd be more afraid of his taser.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. Kind of unique for me. I get to come to you tonight and put money back into the water fund instead of spending.
Wow.
So, when we pursued the purchase of property out at the water treatment plant last year, we kind of knew at that time that we were getting more than what we really wanted for the potential expansion of our raw water reservoir out there. The more that we looked at the property that we had acquired, I sat down with staff out there and we had the discussions, and we talked with Jeff a little bit about wanting to maintain enough of a buffer around our reservoir and everything, and it's called source water protection and everything. And so we've decided that we want to maintain and keep under our control the majority of the ground that we purchased last year. But we acquired the house that went along with the property. It was never our intention to become a landlord and, you know, want to rent that piece of ground. And so we've gone through the process of dividing off the house and the surrounding 15 acres. That has all been approved through the county. And so it is now its own individual parcel that has been exempted off of the 320 acres that we purchased. It took us a little while to get through that process. Now that we've done that, we did go out to basically a closed bid system on the farmhouse, the outbuildings. There's a quality water tap with it and the 15 acres. We left that open for quite a while so we could give people a chance to come out and look at the property. They were allowed to set up as many visits to the property as they wanted to and look at the house. We also felt that we needed to give them enough time that if they needed to check on their financing and everything to make this purchase, that they could do that and have ample time to go to their banker and all that. So when this closed, we ended up having two parties that ended up submitting bids on this. We had more people than that to actually look at it, but we had two parties. And so we received two bids on the purchase of the property out at the water plant. One was in the amount of $195,050, and the other one was $214,417. So I'm here tonight asking for a resolution authorizing the mayor to sign the contract to accept the offer for the $214,417 for the sale of that 15 acres with its outbuildings and the quality water tap. And I would be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Well, and to clarify, there'd be two resolutions. One authorizing acceptance of the bid, and the second resolution, which is a written resolution, authorizing the mayor to sign any of the agreements to get the property transfer.
Thank you, Jason.
Do we have those both in here?
The acceptance of the bid would be an oral resolution, much like you would accept bids for the purchase of a police vehicle or something. But the written resolution is authorizing the mayor to sign all of the agreements is in the packet.
And what was, Brent, what was the amount for the bid from Taylor Reuter? Is it Reuter?
214-417. Nice even number. Easy to memorize.
And which order did you want them done in?
Accepting the bid and then the authorizing the mayor. While you're thinking about that, one thing I would note also in working well with the previous landowner and providing them with what they wanted in this actually saved the city money overall and allowed us to protect the boundaries around the water treatment plan. We initially had budgeted, and we'd budgeted for several years, around $200,000 to go in and get somewhere around 20 to 25 acres out of the, how many total acres? 320 total acres. The final sell price on it was about $435 to get the 435,000 to buy the entire parcel, and then of course with the selling off the 15 and getting 215 back, we spent a little bit more than we expected, but we ended up with a whole lot more. And I think what we demonstrated there is when we're willing to work with people and help them get what they want, we can make a pretty good business transaction out of it. So I want to thank those who participated in that and made that work well for the city.
Did entertain action?
Your Honor, I would offer a resolution accepting the bid from Taylor Reuter in the amount of $214,417 for the property located adjacent to the water treatment plant.
Second. A resolution by Lisa Northrup and a second by Dan Marler. Vote by roll call.
That resolution carries unanimously.
Would entertain action regarding signature.
Your Honor, I would offer a resolution authorizing the mayor to sign a contract for the sale of the property located near the water treatment plant.
Second. I have a resolution by Lisa Northrup and a second by Dan Marler. Vote by roll call, or roll call, please.
That resolution carries unanimously.
Thanks, Thank Brent. You very much. I'll. Reuters were talking about being here tonight, but they currently actually live in the Front Range and are trying to relocate back out here. And so they were very excited at the fact that they were probably going to end up with this piece of property.
Welcome to the community.
Yeah. He's been here. Their family's been around quite a while.
Thanks, Brent.
Next on the agenda is a presentation and possible action on bids for upfitting two police patrol vehicles and one code enforcement vehicle. Lieutenant Crone.
Mayor and Council, good evening. As part of our capital improvement plan, we purchase vehicles just about every single year. This year we've purchased two police patrol vehicles and one code enforcement vehicle to replace current ones that are need to be decommissioned. As part of that, we also need to equip or upfit those vehicles with equipment, anywhere from emergency light bars to internal equipment, whether it's partition cages, so on and so forth, other lighting equipment and so on. That's what this presentation is. Received or put out to bid for the upfits. Went for approximately 3 weeks on this. I received several different bids from just three different companies, which included upfitting two of the patrol vehicles and also one of the code enforcement vehicles. It's not uncommon when you outfit vehicles that occasionally it comes out that certain items that they presented may not be exactly what we want. So at the end of this, my recommendation is going to be a not to an exceed mount, even though it might go a little bit over what the bid was. It's not uncommon for me to meet with the vendor to state, okay, this isn't exactly what we needed. I'd rather have this. Last year, I did the same thing and actually came under what I had expected. The three different vendors were all within Colorado. One was called Laws out of Inglewood, another one Cross Point Communication out of Denver, and the third one was Summit Body Works out of Commerce City. Last year, we utilized Laws Lighting and Equipment to outfit three vehicles. My recommendation this year would be the same thing. They submitted a bid for upfitting the two patrol vehicles for $17,354.68, and a second bid for upfitting the code enforcement vehicle, which would be $3,917.10. Again, my recommendation would be to accept the bid from Laws out of Inglewood, Colorado, not to exceed a total amount of $23,000, although the total amount for the bid was $21,271.78. As I said, we utilized Laws last year. We also utilized them the previous year for upfitting vehicles. They haven't had any issues that they were not able to resolve pretty quickly. I've been in contact even since the bids came out about any other issues that we've had with the current vehicles from last year. We've discussed some of those. We also came up with a little different plan to ensure we didn't have any continuing problems with that. So they've been very helpful, very customer service oriented. So again, that would be my recommendation to utilize Laws out of Inglewood to outfit the three vehicles.
Any questions from council?
Nope. Seeing none, I would entertain action.
Your Honor, I would offer approval for the purchase. Oh, let's try this again. I'm getting tired. I would offer a resolution accepting the bid from Laws of Inglewood, Colorado for a cost not to exceed $23,000 for the purchase and installation of equipment.
Second.
I have a motion by Lisa Northrup, a second by Kevin Lundell. All in favor, vote by roll call.
That resolution carries unanimously.
Thank you, Council.
Thanks, Lieutenant.
Next, we have a presentation and possible action on bids for a four-wheel drive, one-ton pickup for the fire department. Chief Frasco. Been waiting in the wind for a while.
I have a cold, so it's kind of trying to not cough up here. Good evening, everybody. We're looking to buy a one-ton vehicle to replace our fire marshal truck that's been having lots of issues. We put it out to bid for, I think we budgeted $47,500, and we received four bids back from Weld County Garage, Ed Bosler Chevy of Park Meadows, and Johnson's Auto Plaza. The two low bids were $32,914 and $32,179. Well, I didn't choose the lowest bid. I would like to go with Weld County Garage. A couple different reasons. They're closer, so for maintenance of the vehicle, I think that would be simpler for us. I also know the Water Department just purchased two vehicles from the same company, Weld County Garage. Weld County Garage actually came out here to look at the vehicle that we want to trade in. I think that's great customer service and kind of reflects on their company in general. And my other reason is Ed Bosworth's bid package was terrible. It was very hard to understand, and you couldn't tell what you were actually getting. I'm sure they were bidding the same truck, but I can't tell that, and I would prefer not to go with them. So with that, I would ask that for approval to purchase a truck from Weld County Garage and use up to $45,000 of the extra money to purchase all the additional equipment radios, lights, decals, everything else.
Questions of Chief Brasco? Are you doing a trade-in on your current vehicle?
Yes, we are.
What you're doing?
And they offered $1,800 as a trade-in on that vehicle. It's a 97 Ford F-150.
F-150?
I believe so.
Okay, that's fine. No other questions? I'd entertain action.
Your Honor, I would offer a resolution approving the purchase from Weld County Garage in an amount not to exceed $45,000 for a four-wheel drive, one-ton GMC Sierra 3500 heavy-duty pickup to be utilized by the fire department.
Did he say second?
Second.
I have a resolution by Lisa Northrup, a second by Dan Marler. Vote by roll call.
That resolution carries unanimously.
Thanks, Chief.
I almost firsted and then seconded it.
Next, we have a presentation of possible action on bids for the purchase of two columbarium units. Mr. Duke.
Good evening. This is for the purchase of two 64-inch columbarium units at the cemetery. Seeing as how our cemetery foreman, Mr. Underwood, did most of the work on this project, I will turn it over to him now. Thank you.
Good evening. Currently, we have 36 columbarium niches available. We sell on average 28 a year, so given a six-month delivery time typically for the individual unit, this would allow us to kind of get ahead of the game. As Doak said, we are this is part of the 2016 capital improvement budget, which we had $40,000 budgeted for. Advertisement for bids were placed on the city's website March 3rd and made available at City Hall. The bid opening was held on March 15th. The only bid we received was from Cold Spring for $27,688. We did contact three other companies, two of which declined to bid, mainly because Cold Spring is their granite supplier, so they felt they wouldn't be able to competitively bid against Cold Spring. And Wilbert Memorials did submit a bid, but it ended up past the due date. I will add that it was, you know, a good portion higher than the bid that we did receive. With the purchase of these two niche units, we're hoping this provides us, you know, around a four-year window to then address, you know, where we go from there as far as the niches go. So to make it quick and simple, the staff, we're here, we're requesting the council approve to accept the bid from Cold Spring in the amount of $27,688 for two 64-inch columbarium units, plus an additional $1,400 to contract with the crane service to offload the columbarium units and for the construction of the concrete foundation for a total amount not to exceed $29,100.
Is Cold Spring who we bought the last ones from also? I thought that was...
So will these be, because currently the columbariums are inside of the fenced area, correct?
Yes.
Are these, is there still room to put additional columbariums within there?
Yeah, we actually have room for anywhere up to potentially five more, but then we are getting close to, you know, a bit of a pack them in there, you know, approach. There's more than enough room for these two units plus another one in the future, but where we go as far as with the columbariums, and that's definitely a topic for us. Basically an itinerary that's a little shorter on another night in the future. But yes, no, we have plenty of room, the exact same granite. That's another reason why we do find that our bids aren't lend themselves to Cold Spring, is because Cold Spring kind of has the market cornered on this style of granite, you know, until we open up, you know, the idea of maybe doing different sorts of units, octagonals, we're always probably going to be dealing with them, which isn't a problem. As you can see, I think Doak and I were both pretty ecstatic that 3 years later, this amount budgeted, we come in $10,000 underneath what we budgeted for two units. you know, 128 spots, which, as I said, will get us 4 to 6 years down the road.
Okay. Thank you.
Compared to your traditional burials, are you seeing that this is becoming the way most people are leaning towards preservation of remains?
You know, we talk, you know, at the manager meetings and everything, we've talked about millennials versus baby boomers, this and that. I will say that as of now, we are still digging more than we're putting in niches. But also, too, we're looking at a generation that is, you know, which believed in that process more. And you can definitely see the tide beginning to turn. I would say that probably within 10 to 15 years, we're going to see a serious swing in the opposite direction, which will coincide, like I say, this is bigger picture talk down the road, which will coincide when we start making decisions involving pinning the back half of memory gardens versus expansion or, you know, building construction of a new column bearing unit. But I would say that the millennials, the you know, the younger generations, this is probably definitely the way it's going to go. People don't like, you know, you'd say it, but photo albums, baseball cards, all that stuff's kind of going by the wayside. The niches actually are a more cost-effective, quicker way, you know, to memorialize loved ones. And we definitely see that going that way. So I would say that's definitely the trend.
Thank you.
I would entertain action.
Your Honor, I would offer a resolution approving the bid from Cold Spring in the amount not to exceed $29,100 for 2 64 niche column bearing units.
Second.
I have a resolution by Lisa Northrup, second by Dan Marler. Vote by roll call.
That resolution carries unanimously.
Thanks.
Thank you. Next, we have presentation and possible action on proposal and qualifications for South Main Street Improvement Project. Mr. Curtis.
Good evening again. This is for South Main Street improvements between the railroad tracks and the new Acoma. This will be a design build project, which generally consists of demolition and construction of approximately 2,400 feet of rebuilding South Main Street, again, from Burlington to Acoma. The road is intended to have new pavement that's going to be approximately 52 feet wide up near Burlington Avenue and ultimately narrowed down to 24 feet wide where it connects to South Ridge and Acoma as it reaches the city limits. We're also looking to incorporate new curb and gutter sidewalks. Additionally, replacement of the water line that currently only goes to Gateway at this point. We're going to extend it all the way down to Acoma and connect it to the new Acoma water line that got put in to help out again with our looping system. And then it would be prepped to expand up South Ridge to make that connection in future years. Also trying to address some of the drainage issues down there. We know there's a lot of ponding and things. We're going to have to be a little bit creative on that aspect, thus the design build project. And then there's some minor sanitary sewer improvements to get rid of some clay pipe and put in PVC, those kind of things as the new road goes in. And as everyone's aware, this is a well-traveled route and is adjacent to several businesses and residential areas. I feel it's a really good project to take on at this time because, again, with the Acoma and the new school coming on board, it's going to see a lot of activity on West Street, Acoma, and South Main from what we've ever seen in the past. We did put out a request for proposals and qualifications out on the city website, notified several general contractors on February 23rd, made it available at City Hall. The proposals and qualifications were due on March 8th. We did again have several companies call and ask questions and ultimately only received one company that submitted, which is ECI Site Construction Management. Included in your packet, we wanted to understand a magnitude of cost based off some general scope, Brent and I did a lot of preliminary engineering and design to kind of understand what we were going to try and shoot for on getting this project completed. The contractor did provide a various breakdown and magnitude of cost of the various elements incorporated in the project with order of magnitude at approximately $1.26 million. We did generally interview ECI following their application to make sure we understood their proposal, their concepts, and again, how the drainage as well as incorporating sidewalks, curb and gutters are alternatives to non-vehicular traffic, as there's a lot of area that's adjacent that's not in the city limits and is in the county. Also, we wanted to know kind of who their intended subcontractors were. They did recommend utilization of Ransom Boone Excavating. ECI, it was the contractor that is wrapping up the COMA project that did an amazing job. We're under budget on and on schedule. They also did the ball fields. That was a design build project, so they do have that experience. And they're also the one that did the downtown Main Street project in 09. So they've got a very good record and reputation for the community and their work in the city of Fort Morgan. Tonight, staff is asking council approval for city staff to negotiate with ECI for an aggregate amount not to exceed $1.3 million to construct this project, and with authorization for the mayor to execute the applicable agreements and to proceed with the project. And I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have. I think you notice in the beginning the funding sources. This is a large project that involves a lot of different departments and a lot of different things. But I think that goes to the benefit of the city having all of our own utilities that we can do those kind of things and not get it done once and not have to touch it for quite a while.
Can I ask a question? So you state in here that you want to negotiate for an aggregate amount not to exceed $1.3 million.
Yes.
Maybe I just don't get it, but that's higher than what the bid was?
Yes. They provided an order of magnitude. If all these numbers that we looked at, what we were going to utilize towards this project gets you just over 1.3. So we want to be able to have that flexibility to, if we run into a situation, some of these things, until we really get into the design aspect, they do have some costs. I think I mentioned allowances. So for example, professional services, if we really have to dive into what we're going to do with the storm drainage, that area down there, there are some inlets, but some of the pipes only like 8 inches. We're not going to be able to go and put in 72 inch pipe, so we're going to have some creative innovations, whether it's side swales or smaller pipes or change the flows, those kind of things. Of course, there's development on both sides, so that kind of poses its own issues where they're already built lower than the road as it currently exists. So we want to be able to utilize with them as we go through that to be able to make sure that we have the money, we have it in the budget. If once we get into that, what those contracts will show is we'll agree to a design premise and then move forward. So that'll go with the scheduling. They may decide, well, we know the water's cut and dry, let's go put that in first while we're working on some of the other elements. So order of magnitude is just based off of what they've known. They've visited the site with us and staff, and they looked at what Brent and I did as far as our concept design, which is more 2D, but the drainage was just the biggest that we can skin that cat 100 different ways, but we want to have that flexibility because I think as we construct, we may be making modifications as we move along. So
okay.
Hopefully we can use a lot less, but we want to make sure we make the room and do the best we can with the money that we have available. So
thank you.
Okay, Brett, this is a question a lot of people have been asking, and this is one of those situations where some of it's in the county and some of it's not. Okay, on South Sherman, we have a lot, or South Main, we have a lot of, especially on the east side where there's no sidewalk when you get to Burlington. Is that going to be sidewalked now and curbed and guttered? That's not now.
And that's what we're looking at. The bulk of that section we had surveyed last year, and this is very similar if we want to talk about Barlow or Riverside. We want to incorporate as much of that in as we can. Additionally, to provide safety to the new middle school, even if we're only to do one side, we want to make sure we have the proper mechanisms to get them from one side of the street. So if we're only able at this time with the budget that we have to make sure we fully develop sidewalk from one end of the state all the way down to Acoma to get into the new sidewalks, we'll do that. But, and again, like you say, some areas, once you get further down there, they're way down at the hill. But I think it's working against some of those adjacent businesses that, you know, it might even be just an asphalt edge, like a bicycle path, or we just extend that asphalt a little bit more out into where our right-of-way is. So that's what we want to look at. But we want to provide as much accessibility to people as we can with the landmark and the gateway that we have people that want to walk and get up into downtown to give them the sidewalks. We have to bring certain areas for ADA requirements, the west side that has sidewalk, we're going to have to update those intersections. We're required to do that anyways to put in the ADA ramps. So that's, again, as part of doing street projects, that's why we do have to incorporate that. So hopefully we can get as much as we can. That's what we had in our estimate, to plan on curb and gutter and sidewalk on both sides. But if we run into a drainage thing, we'll make sure that we get as much as we can in the short term, but even for future planning, that they can build off of what we put in now.
Now, can we ask the businesses and the residents that are in the county if they want to? I mean, we can't force them to, but can we politely ask them if they'd like to participate or pay for?
Sure, we can ask.
Okay. Have we asked?
Well, you know, one aspect of that is that this comes back to conversations that we've had in the past about annexing into the city. You know, they're right next to the city. They benefit from city services in a lot of different ways. And, you know, we hope that we'll get people interested. Council's given us authorization to provide incentives for people to come into the city through annexation. But, you know, one of the benefits of being within the city limits is that you get to vote for your representatives. You know, we've got to build infrastructure that works for the city as a whole and that will make the city run better, and I think we'll have some people that may not like all of the infrastructure that's constructed over there, but, you know, long term, we're responsible for that road, and they can always annex in and have a say in the process by being within the city limits. We'll help them annex into the city if they'd like to do that and have that voice at the table. But, you know, a lot of those businesses don't annex in the city for whatever reason.
To be honest, I've actually had one of the residents that come to me and complain about something, and I'm like, where do you live? And they said, I live here. And I'm like, here's your county commissioner's name. And like, what? And I'm like, you don't live in the city.
You know, another way.
Down and talk to them.
Yeah. Another way that we can finance some of these improvements in the future, though, is that you can create special improvement districts in these areas, and the owners, adjacent owners, are then responsible for paying for these improvements based upon mill levies that are set on the property to pay back the improvements. And so that's another way that we can look at financing this down the road. I don't imagine, given the price tag of $1.3 million, you're going to get businesses running to participate and financially pay for this, similar to the downtown project, which was completely funded by general fund reserve dollars.
That's for the children.
Everything's for the children.
They'll have the added benefit of snow removal once these come in.
Right.
So they'll get to experience city services and access. But again, it's to provide that connection, and really it's been on everyone's list for a long time. So we want to get as much of that stuff that needs to get done as we possibly can.
So just to clarify, is the road the city's? And the properties are not annexed in, so that's why if they were to be annexed, we would add the curb and the gutter and the sidewalk, or they would help pay for that, or some of the actual road county road.
So this has been kind of the standard for the city when we rebuild streets, even within town. We incorporate some of those upgrades just out of city's general fund or capital budgets. We don't go and ask the owners to fix their proportion. It is in our code, you know, that council can go and say, this is gonna, when we do that, that was how actually the alley started in in Fort Morgan. That was the first thing. It was actually paved in the city, even prior to Main Street, the alleys were, and everyone paid a proportionate share. For the most part, the things we do now, the city does it and covers it under the capital budgets, which comes out of the sales tax and some of the operating budgets. But as far as this, the right-of-way is ours. I think as we look at different areas of town, you know, we may have people parking on what that where the dirt is, but it's really right-of-way. But we don't go and force them to pay. If they do annex in, that's another kind of thing that we've talked about. We don't immediately make them put in curb and gutter and sidewalk. Usually it's a function of once a new building permit is issued, then that's kind of where the compliant structures versus the non-compliant, and that's why trying to work with the county when it's near the city, we want it as compliant to the city's codes so it doesn't become a non-compliant grandfather type of situation when it's annexed. But usually in most areas, if it is new development or new permit, at that time we then require them to put in the sidewalk or curb and gutter. So it's kind of a, if you're lucky enough to get your street rebuilt, sometimes you get the improvements, you know, other times you can do it. We still have sidewalk replacement programs if people want it, that we pay 50% up to 400 square feet. So there's lots of those options that we do when we try and provide to the community.
Thank you. So just to help people at home, let's on South Sherman, this will clarify if you're going down Western Millwright, Western Groceries, I guess that's what it's still called. That's in the city limits. That's west side of South Sherman or South Main.
You're talking like where American
yes.
Family
is? Yes. Yes, just that immediate part. But okay. On the other side of the street, it's not.
On the east side where the Pottery Barn, I guess that's mm-hmm. what it's called. Yeah. That is not in the house.
Yeah.
That's all
and
those
the
two.
Auto place. Yeah.
Those are not. So that's what we're talking about. So that's why that's not paved. And then, of course, you got a house that's in between Landmark and those businesses that's not in the county. That's in the county, so that's why that's not paved. So it's a little bit.
So those houses that are along the, I guess, heading south, that are on the left-hand side, those four or five houses, those are not in the city limit?
No. And that's the one of the residents that did come up to me that had a question. And I'm like, your county commissioner is Mrs. Teague, so you need to give her a call.
And those are the coordination efforts we're still going to have because, again, when we have driveways and sidewalks and versus the whole property is accessible, that's where those communications that we'll have. But, again, we've got to look at drainage, and as long as they're there, we don't want to make the drainage worse. So the roads like that, we don't want to build it up higher, and that might be where we just end up extending out the asphalt to still make a safe path, similar to north side of the cemetery when we did that with the safe routes several years ago. It's actually just a paved shoulder that connects to the trail that goes up to Logling Village. So there may be a hybrid of a little bit of all those.
The overall goal is to improve it.
Absolutely.
For everyone.
Yep.
It's not to create problems for anybody.
Absolutely.
There are those inconsistencies in development standards between the city and the county that we run into when you have city infrastructure abutting a county property. And those are things that we're trying to fix through agreements. Actually, we had a really good meeting with the county commissioners this week to try and come up with agreements to prevent those things from happening with future development. But the idea is let's improve the situation altogether, not cause problems for people as we do it, and make it a better road for everybody that's going to be traveling that like crazy when they drop their kids off to middle school.
But we'd like to clarify, though, please note, but if there's an emergency or a criminal emergency or a fire emergency, our guys will respond to those residents. If something of criminal activity is going on, our Fort Morgan Police Department will say, well, that's in the county, we'll still go.
Well, they'll assist, but they don't have jurisdiction.
Right.
I mean, if there's a burglary going on over there, they'll show up and assist, but they don't have jurisdiction. The county sheriff has to show up and make arrests and file charges. The city doesn't.
Correct.
But we'll be there to assist.
And that's what the issue was, that I'm like,
well, and we're all county taxpayers, regardless of whether you live in the city or the county. But we have, you know, the sheriff has to patrol specific areas that are still their responsibility and their jurisdiction within the city. And so that's kind of wasted resources, but that's a whole other issue.
Yeah.
We just want to build a road right now.
We want to build a road and put some more water lines in.
Right. Yeah.
So when they do get annexed, it, Brent can, they can connect them up and we're good to go. So.
Brad just wants to build a road.
We want to build a road.
Some sidewalks.
Yep. We're done filling in potholes that don't last for, through the next rain, so it's time to rebuild that sucker.
<That's true. laughs>
Any other comments, questions? If not, I would entertain action.
Your Honor, I would offer a resolution approving city staff to negotiate with ECI for an aggregate amount not to exceed $1.3 million to construct the project and authorize the mayor to execute the applicable city agreements to proceed with the South Main Street project.
I second it with gusto.
A resolution by Lisa Northrup, a second by Joe Segura. Vote by roll call.
That resolution carries unanimously.
I think that's the most money I've ever approved.
And I'm glad to see it.
Next, I have a presentation and possible action on bids for the city complex building entryway ADA upgrades project. Mr. Curtis.
Thank you. This is a carryover from bringing things up to ADA compliance. A few years ago, we had done the bathrooms within the complex. We had gone out to bid several times for this work. It's actually the south entrance to the city complex utility billing. The entryway doesn't meet ADA as far as door accesses, maneuverability, and those elements. So we want to improve that. We also have to do some concrete work as you enter into the utility billing portion. And while we're at it, there are several offices that are very dark without windows. So we added the option while they're there. Honestly, my office is now one of them. So to get a little bit more light and functionality in the building. So the original request was in August of 2015. Again, we have several local contractors that attend, and then timing, just we hadn't received bids. We did post it again this February, and we did receive one bid from SLS Industrial Services in Fort Morgan. The bid to do the primary work as far as the vestibules are concern was $29,400, and then additionally to do the concrete work in front of the utility billing was $1,280, and then they also provided an optional cost for $4,000 apiece to put in the windows that would be where the brick is on the west side of the building. Staff's requesting council approval to accept the proposal from SLS in the amount of $29,500 to complete the complex building upgrades project, along with approval for the installation of windows and the installation of the concrete, for a total amount not to exceed $47,500. That would be the full budget amount. That's a carryover from 2015. It does come out of the electric fund because the electric department does own that building.
Can't they just put more lights and a mural on your wall?
They probably could.
We don't want them growing anymore. So.
Well, Brent's taken advantage of all my plants that have grown really big, and now I have none. And so, you know, that kind of thing.
So your plants have been put into foster
care? Right, so that's what it's for. So,
what plants are
but some of the other thoughts we've had, I think, you know, as far as getting one into the conference room, and I know we have a couple other offices for staff that are pretty much don't even have indirect light. So we can get those in. It'll help everyone. And it's a wellness thing, right, Michael? Additional windows and sunlight and stuff. All right.
Oh, is Michael back there?
He's hiding.
Oh.
So if you got any other ADA questions, he can come on up. But I think we kind of hopefully covered it. But any other questions you may have?
Are we done with the ADA now?
No.
Even close.
Far from it.
You're never done with the ADA.
We are saddled with that for.
Because we were lucky.
As long as ADA's around, we will be doing that.
Which is a good thing.
So you're asking for not to exceed 47.5.
Yes.
And that's
to do the bulk of what we needed in addition to the optional for as many windows. I think it'll allow us to get four windows in.
That's $4,000 per window?
They're special windows.
So that would be, right, since we've already got it. We've had other contractors look at it, too. Some of the numbers go up and down, but since we had that budget and it's carried over, otherwise you can deny it and we'll go look for, we could probably get cheaper in some areas, but we felt to bring it to council while the contractor's there and disturbing the whole building. That'll be a, one area's gonna be closed, so we're gonna have to change accessibility while we're doing that construction, so it might be worth just getting them done while everything's being disrupted, so.
Any other questions?
No, sir.
Entertain action.
Your Honor, I would offer a resolution approving acceptance of the bid from SLS Industrial Services in an amount not to exceed $47,500 to complete the city complex building entryway ADA upgrades, along with approval for the installation of windows and installation of concrete at the utility building entrance.
Second.
A resolution by Lisa Northrup, a second by Kevin Lindell. Vote by roll call.
That resolution carries unanimously.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next, we have a presentation and possible action on a resolution regarding revocable right-of-way permits. Mr. Wells.
Thank you, Your Honor. This hopefully will be a fairly simple presentation. Essentially, what we're requesting is that council pass the resolution which would authorize the revocation of right-of-way permits that have been issued in business areas. We issue right-of-way permits all the time, generally to businesses that provide public services, telephone companies, cable companies, and they're allowed to use the public's right-of-way for the development of a private business that benefits the public. The public owns the streets, they own other areas, and in order for a private company to be able to use that, City Council has the authority under the charter to allow that to happen. A revocable right-of-way usually occurs in an area where we have individual businesses benefiting from use of the public right-of-way for that business that isn't necessarily set up for a public purpose as a whole. So, for example, if you look up and down Main Street, we have various businesses that have extended out onto the sidewalk certain areas of their business to provide service to people out of doors. Cables is an example. Acapulco Bay is an example. But a revocable right-of-way isn't just limited to a patio seating area. We have revocable right-of-ways for people to put a table full of goods out on the front of their building, or a bench and planters. They range widely on how they're issued. One of the concerns that has come up is as the police department has gone down to enforce these revocable right-of-ways, there are inconsistent allowances, I guess, for business to business. And we want to make sure that when we issue these, that they provide a consistent pattern of what's allowed, what's not allowed, and make sure that we maintain the decorum of the downtown area that would be pleasing to everyone that comes in that area. I think a lot of people look at some of those improvements and they think that they're permanent. They are not. They're required to be removed within a 72-hour notice. I know some of them look like they're permanent, but we've looked at the design, for example, of cables, and all of that is put in there with bolts that could easily be pulled out and removed within a 72-hour notice. So we want to make sure that we're being consistent with how we apply this. The legal issue that's come up is that in the ordinances, council has authorized the city manager to issue these, but there's no direct authorization that says I have the right to revoke them. Now, obviously, it would make sense if you allow me to grant them, you allow me to revoke them, but in an effort to provide public information about what the process is and what we're doing, as well as making sure that it's clear that I have the authority to revoke these and then reissue them with consistent conditions, we're asking the council to pass this resolution, make sure I have that authorization. You know, the process wouldn't be that we just go out and revoke them and nobody has the right to do this. The idea would be that we present what the new standards would be for all of the businesses in a letter. Here's what we're planning on doing. Here's the deadlines. Here's what we're planning on moving forward with, following the fees that are established in the budget process. And then January 1st, everyone would have a deadline to come in and apply for a new right-of-way permit. We probably wouldn't, with these new permits, we could do some waiving of fees for that first year, and then after that, everyone would be subject to the fees. But that's kind of how we want to move on. Brad, did I miss anything with that process? Because I know this is something we've been looking at for a long time and trying to make it work for everyone in the downtown area.
Really, the only correction is several years ago, it used to be only for downtown, but it's actually citywide. It's opened up to that. One example would be the Fort Morgan Shopping Center, that actually the overhead is actually within the city's right of way. But that's, it's to clean it up. Some of them are so out of date. Requirements are similar to any other work that's in the right of way, is they need to be providing us accurate insurance and those kind of items. So we just want to reestablish a good baseline for some of those, and make sure we're consistent, especially with code enforcement, to make sure that we know which ones are revocable and which ones are been put out there that don't necessarily have a revocable permit. So.
Do we have anybody that we currently, if we were to do a blanket revocation, that when they came in to apply for their permit would not be allowed to be? I guess, long story short, do we have anybody who we would not reissue?
Not of any significant nature that would cause them any significant cost to upgrade to a current standard, no.
Thank you.
How will we determine the standards by which these will be given out in the future? You mentioned consistency. Can you speak to that a little bit?
It's gone different, as Jeff's mentioned. City manager has had ownership of it at one time, planning and zoning. So again, but then code enforcement enforces it. So that's one that we'll come back and say, this is, you know, whether it comes through the planning and zoning department, we're usually the ones that deal with those, because it is consistent with just general right of ways. So we've got to look at ADA accessibility, public access, potential utilities. So that's kind of the direction would be coming from us. But right now, if we do issue one, city manager reviews it, city clerk reviews it, the police chief reviews it, because again, it is in our public right of way. So we'll just pick one agency that will be the keeper of that. Kind of similar to even annually, we already do that in planning and zoning. We send out reminders to all contractors to renew at the starting of the year. This would be a similar process that would be easily adaptable and utilize some of the software that we use with the finance department that we currently have to be able to provide those notices.
So another aspect of consistency would be, you know, we've had some businesses that do not have a right-of-way and have come in and requested one, and we have denied them at this point, but there are other people that are doing similar things. One example would be taking things out of your store and putting them on the sidewalk every day. So where, you know, we don't want a situation where it looks like Main Street is a flea market every day. Now, there are days that we do. I think there's times when we have festivals and other things going on downtown. And with that, we've talked about doing a blanket right-of-way permit for all of the businesses downtown on specific days, and coordinating with the Downtown Business Association or the businesses downtown to say what days would make a lot of sense that everybody could have a sidewalk sale. But for someone to put out their wares every single day creates issues for signage. It creates issues for that movement up and down Main Street. And then the overall decorum of downtown also, I think, is affected when you don't have consistent, here's what you can and can't be putting out on the right-of-way for sale. And so that's another consistent aspect that we're going to be looking at.
I guess I was wondering, who's determining the rules for consistency?
Jason.
Okay. No. Well, Brad mentioned the planning and zoning committee. So I think that answers it. I guess if I'm a business owner and I'm thinking that I should be able to get the variance, people down the way have a variance, or not a variance, but have the
right of way,
revocable right of way. you know, how come you're not giving me mine? And there's got to be, for the consistency's sake, as you've mentioned, there's got to be rules and guidelines for that. And I was just wondering where those rules and guidelines are going to come from and what they will look like, I guess.
And we already have the majority of those because we do talk about that, especially when we talk about some of the restaurants. And that's where John becomes involved because some of them also want to use them to serve liquor. So that's why we do actually have that criteria as far as, you know, some of those additional standards. But, you know, when we're talking about planters and benches, you know, versus putting out, you know, used furniture or something like that, those are, that's kind of that fine line of, you know, what we really want to have out there. From an aesthetic standpoint, as Jeff mentions. And we've had right-of-way permits. They just want it for a couple months because they're doing a sale or something like that, and then they have no interest of continuing it versus some that you see that look to be a little bit more permanent.
So no couches on the sidewalk?
To your concern, we could certainly codify or make some sort of written policy that would address every single issue. It would be extremely cumbersome to do so because of the variety of uses and types of permits. And so some discretion makes sense in an issue like this where you have somebody who's wanting to put out a thing of flowers for the month of July because for whatever reason versus somebody who's trying to extend their patio seating area, and those are completely different uses. Same right-of-way, same permit, but completely different way of handling those scenarios. And so I don't know if there's to date any specific codified this is exactly what criteria checklist we have, but to do so would get very cumbersome very quickly.
What about guiding principles at least?
And I think that's what's within policy and what we've typically continued to do. It's not something I do, thankfully. You know, it's if City Council wants it done that way, certainly we can look into it. But
and I think right now, when you look at the general aesthetic nature of downtown, and you look from neighborhood to neighborhood, it's not just for the downtown. You may have a different standard over at the Fort Morgan Shopping Center of what you would allow over there versus what you might allow in downtown. Wanting to maintain that primary commercial corridor as aesthetically pleasing as possible, especially given the fact that the taxpayers invested, you know, almost $4 million, $3.5 million in there just a few years ago. You want to make sure that that investment is well maintained and that whatever goes into that right of way is reflective of that investment.
Alrighty.
That's your questions?
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions? I would entertain action.
Your Honor, I would offer a resolution authorizing and directing the city manager to update the revocable right-of-way permits previously issued by the City of Fort Morgan.
Second.
I have a resolution by Lisa Northrup and a second by Daniel Marler. Vote by roll call.
That resolution carries unanimously.
Next, we have a presentation and direction on calculation of a stormwater fee. Mr. Wells, Curtis, and Nation.
Your Honor, yes, I request a brief recess.
Oh, short recess?
Yes.
Everybody wants recess.
That's fine, sure.
Because this is going to be a fun discussion.
We'll take a break for 5 minutes. Okay. Now we're back to calculation of stormwater fees. Mr. Wells.
Thank you, Your Honor. I don't think you realize how excited I am to give this presentation tonight. If you look at it, we've been working on stormwater fees since 2010. The ad hoc committee came back with recommendations in 2012, 2013 on what needed to happen. At that point, we had looked, I think, at everything that you could think about when it comes to a stormwater utility and a stormwater fee. The last several years, we've been looking at different things that council's asked us to look into further. And ultimately, last fall, council passed an ordinance saying, okay, we're gonna move forward, we're gonna create a stormwater utility with the sewer fund, and we're going to establish a fee, and we're gonna move forward with that. We're going to focus on a very narrow issue related to this entire process tonight, which is a recommendation by staff
of how we will calculate the fee. Not what the fee is going to be, how much it's going to cost. We're just talking about how are we going to calculate these things. I'm going to go through this PowerPoint presentation that was presented and prepared by Colette to keep me on task. I was told tonight, don't get off in the weeds. Keep focused. There's so many things we could talk about, but let's stay on topic. If you have any other questions tonight, we definitely want to answer them as we go through this process. If we start getting off in the weeds, we may save that for another time, or we can talk offline and answer any questions you might have. Want to thank staff. We've spent a lot of time getting to this point, and I think we've come up with a really good option. So there are a lot of different ways that we could actually calculate the fee. Some of them are more, entailed than others. What we tried to do is set out, a process that would not be too difficult or complex from a management side, but yet be fair and simple in a way, simple enough to also be fair to every homeowner. So to give you an example of something that might be very labor intensive and take a lot of time and money to manage, it would be something similar to what Greeley has. They go into every single lot within the city. They determine what's permeable, what's not permeable. They have a rate for permeable and non-permeable acreage or footage within a lot, and that's how they calculate your rate. Where that gets difficult is you have to go in and GPS all those coordinates. You have to calculate what all the permeable versus non-permeable areas in every single lot within the city. But then if there's any kind of a change to that lot, somebody adds a driveway, somebody adds a shed, somebody does an addition on their home, or adds any kind of non-permeable surface, that has to be regulated through the planning department and building codes. Once you go and get a permit, then that's forwarded on to the water department or the stormwater department that then recalculates your fee, which goes to the utility billing department, which would then send that bill to your house. So this ongoing process of requiring to constantly monitor every property in town would be probably the most fair way to do this, because you would know down to the square inch of every property of what was permeable, non-permeable, and it would apply equally to everybody across the board. We don't want to spend all the money that we get on a fee to manage the fee calculation itself. We would have to hire additional people. We would have to get additional equipment, and we would be spending a lot of money and time just to determine what everybody at every lot should be dealing with. The other side of that, we had something as simple as saying, what's your tap size, your water tap size, and we figure out, okay, here's, if you've got a 6-inch tap, you've probably got this much permeable versus non-permeable because you're gonna be a commercial or an industrial use, and we kind of know what that is, and we would charge you by that. Each one of those options has legal risks associated with it, whether it's fair or not. And that was kind of on the other side. It really wouldn't be that hard. We already have all the tap size in the utility billing system, and we could just attach a fee to each one of those taps, and then we could take care of it. But then the question is there a legal or a logical nexus between a water tap and how much stormwater you contribute to the overall stormwater issues within the city? So we've taken those two ideas on polar opposites and pushed them together to come up with this characterization. So this identifies different ways that you look at that. You can do linear frontage of a building lot. That's similar to what Brush does. They say if you have so much linear foot in front of your house, building, whatever it is, you pay a specific fee per foot, linear feet that you have. Again, that's more on the simple side. And then there's also questions as to how fair that is. Overall, we wanted the implementation of fees to be simple with minimal cost to calculate the billing, fees to apply to every property in the city. This is one of the standards that we set. We talked about, do we make exemptions? Do we say if it's for the children, you don't pay, or if it's for a city facility, you don't pay, or if it's a county facility, or if it's a church, or do we start carving out exceptions to the fee? And we determine that's not a good idea. You apply a fee to everybody. Everybody pays the fee, just like you do for sewer, just like you do for water. It is utility. You don't carve out exemptions. Everybody pays because everybody contributes to the fee. So each address in the city will be assessed the fee based upon their zoning and then actual assessments to the property in the county. And that's basically what we've come up with, is that we will look at each parcel within the city. We have a parcel map. We can identify each of those properties. We can determine what the average size is for each lot in each zoning area. And we will first start with the zoning and say, okay, if you are residential, your average size is this big of a lot, and we establish a base rate based upon the average size of a residential lot for a residential stormwater customer. We then take that, and if you have a bigger lot, let's say you have an acre
lot,
that everyone else has a quarter of an acre lot, and you have a full acre, everybody would be assessed the quarter acre base rate, and then we would do an addition if your lot is actually bigger than that. So we make sure that everybody's paying at least the base on what the average lot size is for residential, and we'd have a residential calculation based upon what average permeable versus non-permeable is going off of averages, and then there would be an adder. If you have a bigger lot, you would be required to pay a larger fee associated with what your zoning is. Am I off topic yet? We're going to, okay. The second layer that we would look at is actual use. Let's say you're an industrial zone. You might end up with an industrial bill, but you have a house in an industrial zone, and that happens in some places. You have a non-conforming use, or you have an area that might be zoned as business, but it's still kind of got residential feel to it. We would then look at, what does the county assessor have you on their records? Are you actually being assessed taxes at a residential level or at an industrial level? And if it's a residential level, then you'll get the residential treatment, even though you may be zoned in a higher use, I guess, or a different use. So that way, we make sure that everybody in the process is actually getting a bill for the actual use of their property and not just for the zoning. But we start out with zoning, then we go to the actual uses that we can pull from the assessor's records and make sure that the appropriate use is being, the appropriate fee is being applied. We go one more level than that, and we say, okay, if you don't agree as an individual property owner of the characterization of your property, you can come in and actually appeal the determination set on your property by the city. So if we say it's industrial or commercial and the use is being taxed industrial or commercial, but you still believe that your use somehow has been mischaracterized by the county or the zoning doesn't make sense, then we'll come up with specific legal criteria that you can come in and say, I want an exemption or I want a variance, essentially, on what we're doing here. And staff would look at that. They'd apply those same criteria that the council would apply when it looked at the situation. And we would say, yes, okay, yeah, you do have kind of unique property, and the use is unique, and it really doesn't fall within what we've characterized that. We do a separate characterization. Wouldn't give them rights under the zoning code to do something different on that property if we zoned it industrial or residential, even though it was an industrial thing. Wouldn't say that you have rights to that use. It would just change what your billing characterization is. They don't like what staff says, they could take it to city council, and city council could look at it, apply those general legal criteria, and say, well, yeah, maybe staff doesn't see it completely the way it should be seen under these criteria, and they could say, yeah, it really should be characterized as this. So all we're looking at now is characterization of the properties, and the fee comes after that. So once we characterize each of the properties within the city, then we determine what the fee is. Still on the strong point. So going back to that, we establish a base rate for each of the properties. If the average residential property, for example, is a quarter acre, there would be a base rate, and everybody would pay that. If you're a little bit smaller than a quarter acre, you still pay the base rate. But if you're larger than a quarter acre, we'd figure out what that is. If somebody has a five-acre lot in the city and they're residential, they shouldn't be paying a quarter acre. A quarter acre base rate, and then we would have a multiplier for the number of square footage beyond that, whatever that quarter acre number is, and their bill would be calculated based upon that. But that way we don't have to do all permeable versus impermeable. So due to the difference in permeable versus non-permeable services that exist between zoning use districts, the base rate fee for each zone reflect that difference. So an industrial fee is going to be higher than a residential fee, because in most cases, industrial, if you go to Cargill, I don't know how many of you have been there, but they don't have a lot of lush gardens and open grassy areas, places that infiltrate water. Most of it is a non-permeable, and water sheets off that and creates more of a runoff issue for our system. Urban agriculture, on the other side of that, if you go down to Riverside Park, I think a lot of that zoned urban agricultural, and it is almost all permeable. There's very few non-permeable areas. It's actually going to help soak up water rather than anything else. So each property owner would have the right to this administrative appeal, and then the appeals first made to the city manager and staff, and then to city council. If council approves this method of calculation, staff will finish developing an operating budget for the stormwater utility. I mean, we're going to go out and say, what is it going to take for the day-to-day operations? Right now, the streets department pays or spends between $300,000 and $350,000 a year in maintaining, repairing, and fixing stormwater throughout the city. It's a general fund budget operation. We don't have enough money for the streets right now, so we're basically taking the money that's normally going for the streets to manage the stormwater. In addition to the money to manage this, or not having enough money to manage our current stormwater situation out of the general fund, we anticipate that regulations from the EPA will continue to be imposed upon municipalities to regulate and treat stormwater in order to meet the Clean Water Act and pollution into the rivers. So we also need to prepare ourselves to be putting in and meeting some of the requirements that the EPA is putting in place now, so we don't have a situation where last minute they come in and slap a big fine on us and say, you're going to build all of this stuff, and if you don't, then what was the threat with the wastewater plant? We'll own the city or something? I don't know what their threat was.
The assessed value of $1 million and come in.
Yep.
Total assets for the city weren't $47 million at the time.
Yeah. So you turn over the keys to the city, to the EPA, and let them run the city, or you build this new plant. And I guess that's what we want to avoid. We don't want to have a situation where we have to automatically take a whole lot of resources from parks or other things. We need to start planning for this now. So what we'll do is we'll put together this, here's what our operating budget is. Initially, as council had directed, we will include a transfer out of the general fund to the same level that we're doing now, about $300,000. We'll go into this fund to help manage some of these operating fees. Brent and Brad are working on what is that operating budget going to look like to maintain and take care of our current system and provide for some repairs that maintenance repairs that need to be made in the system. Second part of that is the capital budget. We have projects probably totaling $8 million at this point, maybe a little bit more to preliminary design.
That's just for one area.
That's just for one area. We got a project for one area about $8 million. If you recall, Brad did a really good job with the South Sherman construction. That was a grant, and when we got that grant, Dola said, well, until you get a fee, there will be no more grants. So we're gonna look for ways to leverage grants to help with this, but we have several million dollars worth of projects that are out there, capital projects, that we can go out and bond and take care of and build those sooner rather than later to alleviate some of the flooding that's happening within the city. So here's the plan. We're not asking, if you're okay with this calculation, I guess I'm not going fast enough on my slides. That's the last slide. So the plan is this. If you're okay with us using this type of a formula to characterize a fee for each of the individual properties within the city and coming up with what that would be, The plan would be to come back to council as soon as we could get it prepared, obviously before the end of next year, or the end of this year, first of next year, and say, here's what the fee's going to be generally to meet the maintenance costs. This is what the fee would have to be. Now, here's the different projects and what they're going to cost. And if we go out and want to build these out in 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, this is what the fee is going to be for however aggressive the community wants to be in building these projects. Give council the opportunity to say, what does the community really want? Instead of coming out and saying, we want to do a fee for $5, we don't know what $5 would buy us, we don't know where it would get us, and it really doesn't attack or address the problems that we're seeing now or give us an idea of how that would address the problem. If you're okay with this characterization, we come back and we can say, if you do $5, you can get this done in 20 years. If you do $7, and I'm just making these up, so don't hold me to these, we don't know what they are at this point, but I know, Mr. Anderson, it seems weird that I'm saying numbers that may not hold true, but what's that?
Green weeds.
I'm in the weeds, sorry. Focusing.
He's in the rough.
No calculations. Methodology.
Right. So we're just going to do the methodology. The idea would be when we get back, we can tell you generally to get these things completed in these time frames, in these projects in these time frames, you're going to need a fee about this much. So then the community can say, do we want to do this in 20 years, 10 years, 5 years, 2 years? We can hear back from them on what their wants and needs are, and then that ultimately will give you direction on what fee level we need to set in order to meet the needs of the community. So that's our plan. I'll open it up for any questions. Did I miss anything? All right. Any questions on characterization and the plan?
No, I think we need to have a proposal and come up with a plan. We're not going to get any more grant funding for anything stormwater wise if we don't have a fee or some rationale for a fee. And then once you come up with it and give us the numbers, I think we need to do public participation and get the public input on how long and what projects or how long we want to spend on completing the capital projects on the stormwater side of things that we'd want to see accomplished.
Right, and I think the big direction that we're looking for tonight is, does this calculation make sense to you?
Yes.
Going zoning, use, and then having a process where if somebody doesn't agree with it, they can still come in and have us review that characterization.
I think it makes sense. I think we could, you know, you could get down to the granular level when you get down on the permeable, but that's just craziness. I mean, it's just, they would still come back and they would still appeal it, and we would still have twice as many staff to handle the appeal. So, you know, consistent across the board, you know, this is what residential is for a lot, and if you're over that size lot, then it's this percentage more. I think it's very sterile, it's very clean cut, and I think it'll be easier to manage.
I think we want the biggest bang for our buck that we'll get out of what we're needing or wanting to maintain and develop as far as our stormwater, as opposed to getting nitpicky and having to hire a ton of additional staff and make it a nightmare. The old KISS method works really good in this, especially starting out, in my opinion.
Because this method would be all systematically established, right? Mm-hmm. So it's, I mean, somebody's obviously going to have to start the process, but it's not a major staff. Jeannie will do it?
No.
Oh, Chelsea will do it. Awesome. Well,
we will start. We've got the maps, and we can start looking at this internally using the current information we have. It's not going to be perfect. That's why we have processes to allow people to come in if we've missed something to make those adjustments. But what it doesn't require us is take that $300,000 out of the general fund and pay it in salaries. It just goes right salaries for people to do new things. It keeps our current process moving forward, so we don't have to assess a fee
specifically for that. I'm a little bit confused, though, but this is something that we're going to hit on. Let's say you have a large corner lot, for example, and the large corner lot person has a lot of grass, and the backyard's a lot of grass. You know, so it's permeable. Mm-hmm. Next door neighbor has a small lot, but two large garage, so he has a lot of concrete. You're going to charge the guy, for example, that has a two-car garage but small but a bunch of grass, more money, but yet he's contributed less stormwater than the next-door neighbor with a lot of concrete, which is making more stormwater.
But they're probably similarly sized residential lots, so they're, if I'm understanding, so their rate's going to be relatively similar. It's not like
it's
you have...
It's based on averages.
It's so going to be
we're
average.
Not going to go right. by the actual lot. It's going to be based
okay.
You're
a ranchette versus...
I'm a little bit confused. That's what I was confused yeah. about.
So if the average lot... So, for example, my lot, my personal lot...
Well, that's what I was trying to get at myself. That's
and, what and I'm going to be smaller than the average lot, but I'm going to pay the average rate. And so, for me, one might say, well, it's not completely fair because my lot is a little bit smaller than everybody else on my block, but... At the same time, it's the average, and everybody's paying at least.
So that's what I was confused about because I have a corner lot, but I have quite a bit of grass, both back and front. But I have a neighbor, comparison-wise, his is mostly concrete, so compared to what I have. So that's what I was confused about.
Is, but you don't want to personalize.
Yeah, it's just the average. Though. If there's only two lots in the city, we would take the two,
okay.
figure out the difference. And again, that's we know some are going to have concrete, and that's why we don't want to get into details.
Okay.
But that's why we want to have that appeal process. So when we assess that, because, yeah, some are going to pay a little bit more than they think, maybe some a little bit less. But that's why we want to gather that information from actual parcel data from the county to say residential in general, this seems to be the biggest range of lot sizes. And that's okay. how that'll work. And it really applies more, I think, when you think about it. You'll see the biggest difference when we talk about commercial, industrial, those kind of things. So you have the businesses downtown versus a Walmart. That's, you know, that's where we want to make sure when we figure out that average, that's how that kind of comes into play. So.
And to your point, the amount of permeable versus non-permeable space can be done, but we would just be spending pretty much everything that we're going
right.
to be assessing in a reasonable fee to calculate that, and now we're at a net zero gain of...
Correct. Okay.
And an important aspect of this process is to get the public involved. Obviously, they're going to hear about this, and there's going to be some feedback, and that's good. We want to hear the feedback. We want to talk about this. We've been talking about it for 6 years now. We've made decisions to move forward. We've had public involvement the entire time, and this isn't a point where we plan to not have public involvement. We want to hear back what people think. And there's going to be a lot of different opinions and ideas on how to do this. Ultimately, as we've looked at it, we think that this is going to have the least impact on the overall maintenance of the fee calculation portion of the system and be as fair to everybody as possible. So if you're in the public, please comment. Let us know.
And we've had the public meetings in the different wards regarding the stormwater in the past. So, I mean, this is something, as you've said, we've worked on for a number of years. The regulatory agencies are what are making the requirements. So, Kevin, you?
No, I like I said, I think that it's well thought out and everything, too. It's one of those deals that there's just probably no perfect solution, so you got to try and take and you know a little bit from here and there. But I think the bottom line is, like Jeff said, that if we don't establish something like this, then the ability to get the grants and extra help like we did get on South Sherman and everything is not going to be available to us, and so we end up taking that much more out of the general fund that could be going to streets and everything. So I think it's something we have to do and everything, and you know, before when we talked about this, realizing that almost every other municipality around us already has stormwater fees and everything, I think it's something that, you know, this is one of those things that, well, if we didn't have to do it, it'd be easier to swallow, but we do really need to do it. And I think that the method that they've come up with trying to pick and pull from different ones without utilizing a lot of our resources just to try and establish it is well thought out.
I think any time you do something like this, you're not going to please everyone. It's not going to make everyone happy. No one likes to increase rates or try to figure out what's fair. So I think your best thing is just to go forward. It's what's best for the city. It needs to be done. It's been talked about for a long time. Let's go for it, and hopefully it will improve the city, and we'll see the benefits sooner rather than later.
Yeah.
I would ditto Clint's comments. He said just about everything I would. I would also add thank you for all of the time and work and effort that you've put into putting this together and making this happen. It's been a long road. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Anything else?
Oh, you're not.
So I think with that, you probably have some direction. I think you're on the right path. And
you know, I want to thank staff, too, because we have spent a lot of time, and I appreciate the recognition for that. We're trying to do what's best for the community, and you know, we still are out working with CDOT. We're out working with other agencies that potentially have money for us to fix problems as we go forward to alleviate the burden on our taxpayers and potentially in the future our fee payers, ratepayers. This just gives us more opportunities to leverage that money. When you're working with CDOT and they're going in and doing something, and you can say, listen, we know you're doing this. Can you upsize it? Can you change the design? We'll pay for the cost difference. It's cheaper to work with another agency that's already putting an investment than it is to do it all ourselves. And so we're still looking for those opportunities whenever they come up, looking for grant opportunities. And this is going to help us actually leverage better because we'll have the money available. I think we have our direction. All right.
Okay. Mr. Boyer, I think you're next up on the agenda for action, establishing an ADA advisory committee.
Yes, thank you all. I will hopefully buck the trend and just be very brief tonight. because of the ADA transition plan that we've embarked on, it'd be helpful to have a committee. I will tell you that I don't know everything there is to know about the ADA. I'm learning as I go. There's some talent I know on council and then within staff and then some community members that may have an interest in helping us along in this process. So we'd like to get your permission to establish this committee. We report back to you by the end of this year as to how things went. Our hope is to have the ADA transition plan buttoned up at that point. And then at that point, we would seek comments from the community as per the statute. In this initial committee, we would pick who's on it and then proceed with the plan.
So you're looking to develop similar to what we did with Stormwater Ad Hoc Committee?
You bet, and the REC Ad Hoc Committee. Yeah, very similar to that.
Okay. Council have any comments or?
Good idea. That's a great idea. I work closely with a lot of ADA communities. My son Joey's has autism, so I'm glad that we're doing this.
We need to pass this with a resolution, or?
Yeah, and there should be a prepared written resolution in the packet.
Right. With that, I would entertain action.
Your Honor, I would offer a resolution establishing an ad hoc ADA advisory committee to assist in the formation of a transition plan.
I second.
A resolution by Lisa Northrup, second by Joe Segura. Vote by roll call.
That resolution carries unanimously.
Next, we have a presentation or possible action on a resolution authorizing the mayor to sign a memorandum of understanding for the Rocky Mountain Offender Management System for the probation services. Mr. Brennan.
Thank you, Your Honor. The council may recall about 3 years ago, the municipal court retained the services of Intervention Incorporated to perform supervised probation services. At no cost to the court. It was an offender paid service, and that's worked very well. for the past almost 3 years until March 15th, when the municipal court was informed that intervention was going to close its Fort Morgan location. So Amanda Dunn, the court administrator, contacted Rocky Mountain Offender Management Systems, or RMOMS, to see if they might be able to provide services here. They were planning, I believe, to move in this to this region, but now they're going to actually take over Intervention's leased office space and possibly retain some of their staff, and they will be able to take up those services effective April 18th, which will be over a weekend basically with no lapse in services. So this memorandum of understanding is essentially the same as the one with Intervention, and is at no cost to the court. The financial obligation is on the part of the offender, and so we're asking for council approval of that MOU with RMOMS.
Any questions, comments from council?
Outstanding job by Mandy for going out and finding this service so we don't have that lapse in service.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think this was brought up when we did our tour of the municipal courts, and very commendable for coming up with a free resolve for
and a free
a potential
one
problem, yeah.
Right.
With that, I would entertain action.
Your Honor, I would offer a resolution authorizing the mayor to execute a memorandum of understanding between the City of Fort Morgan and Rocky Mountain Offender Management Systems, RMOMS, concerning probation services.
Second.
I have a resolution by Lisa Northrup, a second by Kevin Lindell.
Seventh.
Vote by roll call.
Talented.
That resolution carries unanimously.
Public comments or participation? Seeing none, we will move to reports by officials.
Seeing none, right?
Seeing none.
No, Brent's here.
Brent's got something.
Just real quick.
He gave us money this time, so I
guess. Yeah. With money. We throughout the winter, we've had one of our storage tanks that has been down. We've been trying to do some paint repair inside of it, and because of the weather, it wasn't cooperating. It took us until just now to get that second tank back up and functioning. I just wanted to let council know, and a little blurb to the press, that because of the fact that we had the tank down for so long, we had to probably super chlorinate the tank to make sure that there wasn't anything in there that would cause problems to our drinking water. And so for the next couple of days, citizens may notice a little bit of elevated chlorine taste or smell in their drinking water. Everything's well within safety limits and everything. The water's been tested that's come out of the tank. It's completely safe to drink. But some of our residents are very keen to the increases of our chlorine residual in our water. And so I just wanted to make everybody aware. We put that tank back online at 2:30 this afternoon. And so those effects will be noticed by some residents in town starting probably tomorrow. That was all I had. Thank you.
So we're going to be starting spring cleanup. Is that underway? No. Yeah. It's been going. Yeah, we've already got that. So
pickups going.
If it's not out, it's too late. Don't be putting more stuff out because we won't pick it up. Once we go through an area, it's picked up. It's picked up once. So.
Okay.
So don't put anything else out. I guess that was the point. Anybody else? I just wanted to thank the police department. They had a fairly interesting situation over in Landmark. I think it was last week. High energy ended up, you know, there's a fire and some violent situations going on, and I think our officers handled that in an extremely professional manner, did an exceptional job.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
And really appreciate how they handled that situation and all the situations they get into. So thanks, Chief.
Thank you.
That's it?
So. Bids, meetings, and announcements. Mr. Brennan.
Thank you, Your Honor. The city is currently accepting sealed unit price bids for 2016 on-call HBP paving services until 3 p.m. on April 14th. Sealed bids for 2016 fertilizer product and application services until 2:30 p.m. on April 15th. and seal bids for the Riverside Park paving projects until 4:30 p.m. on April 22nd. Under meetings, the Planning Commission is scheduled to meet April 11th at 4:30 p.m. here at City Hall. The Airport Advisory Board is scheduled to meet April 13th at noon at the airport. The same day, April 13th, the Golf Course Advisory Board is scheduled to meet at Quail Dunes at 5:30. And on April 18th, the Library Advisory Board is scheduled to meet at 4:30 p.m. in the Museum Community Room. The next City Council meeting will be April 19th, starting at 4:30 p.m. with tours and followed by the regular meeting starting approximately 6 p.m. here at City Hall.
Okay. With that, next is executive session. I would entertain motion to go into executive session.
Your Honor, go ahead. Do we have to say what it's for?
Personal issue.
You should.
You should go into executive session.
I think somebody else was motioning down there, right?
Yes. Somebody do it.
Your Honor, I would offer a motion we go into executive session for the purposes of the city attorney annual evaluation.
Second.
We will adjourn this meeting and move to executive session.